Hello, welcome to the opening weekend of AIR, an extraordinary exhibition in the adjacent galleries. But I'd like to begin by acknowledging the ancestors of the country, of this country, the Jagera, the Turrbal, and the Yagra. I pay my respects to the elders and those yet to be born. It always was and always will be Jagera, Turrbal, and Yagra land. My name is Daniel Browning. I present the art show on ABCRN every Wednesday at 10 a.m. and always on ABC Listen. So welcome to this panel discussion with two extraordinary artists whose work is featured in AIR. It's an exhibition that's curated by one of the most visionary humans I know. Happens to be a curator here at the Queensland Art Gallery and Gallery of Modern Art, who I first met when she was a curator at MUMA, which is the Monash University Museum of Art in Melbourne. And I was struck by, I'm talking about Geraldine Barlow here, I was struck by her ability to build relationships between things that seem disparate and, we're talking about contemporary art here, and build relationships between artists and what they're conversing about in their work and creating really strong exhibitions that made me think. So AIR's been continuously observed by ASMOB here in Australia, the Indigenous and First Nations people. It's present in our cultural practices, in our art making, and it's breathed into existence every day in the oral languages of our country. We've been speaking our languages for over millennia, and I argue in my catalogue essay for AIR that, you know, the spoken word is as powerful as the image, and if you look at the word, you'll see so much, and our words are precious. So AIR invites us to discover the connections to AIR through art and culture. And our panel of First Nations artists explore AIR as an intangible thing, but who create it's manifest visually. It's an absolutely vital element. It makes us all, it connects us all, and it connects us with ancestors, with country, and with story. So let's meet those two artists. Brian Robinson has literally carved out a distinctive presence within a remarkably talented generation of Indigenous Australian artists. Raised on Wyben, Thursday Island, and now Cairns-based, he's become known for his graphic prints, contemporary sculptures, and public art that read as episodes in an intriguing narrative, revealing the strong tradition of storytelling within his family and his community. Robinson's artworks present an intoxicating worldview. A constellation of details absorb you into spaces that are at once foreign and familiar, and a gentle but liberating sense of disorientation and surprise takes hold. Yhonnie Scarce was born in Woomera, that's in South Australia, and she belongs to the Kokatha and Nukunu peoples. Scarce's interdisciplinary practice explores the political nature and aesthetic qualities of glass and of photography. Her work often references the ongoing effects of colonisation on Aboriginal people generally, on her family in particular. And family history is central to Yhonnie's work. Drawing on the strength of her ancestors, she offers herself as a conduit, sharing their significant stories from the past. Can you please welcome Brian Robinson and Yhonnie Scarce? I'd also like to acknowledge someone in the room. Is it Professor now? Professor Fiona Foley? One of this state's leading practitioners over very many years, whose practice proves what radical art actually means. So Fiona, welcome and thanks for being here. We're humbled by your presence. People always laugh and think I'm being, cynical or sarcastic, yeah. But I'm not. No. And when I'm actually being sarcastic, people think I'm being serious. I can't win. So this concept of AIR is a tricky one. It's immaterial. We can't see it. And I think I talk about in my catalogue essay how I searched our languages to see if I could find a word for AIR. You know, we don't really have a word for AIR. We have many words for winds.
Yeah, definitely.
But winds aren't necessarily AIR. Atmospheric, the atmosphere around us, doesn't really have a presence in our languages. And it always makes me think, well, what did they... It was visible in smoke. It was visible in clouds. It's visible in whirly-whirlies across country. It's visible in the breath in cold weather, visible in so many ways. And what really struck me about the work we're going to be talking about, well, between your work and Dee Harding's and Jonathan Jones's, was this idea of the breath, and the breath being integral to, you know, sustaining relationships. We need to speak to each other and communicate. Our languages are the bedrock of that long history of communication and relationship. But you actually use your mouth, Yhonnie, in your extraordinary works. You create these, hand-blown and mouth-blown glass. Talk about this, the exhalation, the expiration of breath in your work.
Well, well, as a glass blower, you have to use your breath. So it's kind of, you know, it's part of the process. It's a given. So it's interesting, yeah, because people often say what you did, yeah, that it's hand blown or mouth blown. Mm-hmm. So it's, you use your
and
mouth.
The same thing.
The same thing, but it's kind of like it's, but I guess technically when you're watching someone who was blowing glass, it can be both. Mm. Like it's it's extremely physical, and with glass itself, it needs a lot of your breath. So I was saying yesterday that there's 1,000 breaths in this work. Mm. So because there's 1,000 pieces, so that's a lot of breath and a lot of air really that's gone into that. So yeah, but. Mouth blown, I think, because of the tool that you use to be a glass blower is a pipe. So you put your mouth to the pipe and exhale, really. So, and then hand blown is that element of using tools to make the work once your air is in the piece. Mm. So, and it continues to be that way. Like with the yams in cloud chamber, it depends on the heat of the glass. Like it could be one breath. And then that's all you need, or there could be multiple. Mm. Yeah, yeah.
And I know you very well, and I've known you for many years. 10 years, 15 years, long time.
Yeah.
Anyway,
longest time.
But I've written about you many times. But the hot shop where you, in infernal heat, you produce these lustrous, sensuous forms, in which are elongated bush yams. We'll talk about them in a minute, but it's always a mystery to me. Mm. It's like this, I actually need to come with you to the hot shop at the Jam Factory in Adelaide where you produce all these works and watch you do it, because I write about it and I go, I think I know what's happening.
Yeah, yeah, and I'm surprised you haven't come and seen it.
I've seen video of it, and there is something mysterious about it.
Yeah, and you have to see it in person too, I think, because there is an intimacy with making glass work, and it is also with your assistants as well that work with you. With Cloud Chamber, this was made during the pandemic, and so I relied on the associates at the glass studio in Adelaide. So
you couldn't possibly blow all of those forms by yourself.
By myself.
You used to though. You never had assistance before.
Yeah, I used to. So not so much these days. But I have sore wrists, unfortunately. So because you are making,
because you're holding the tube, and the glass is at the end, molten glass.
Yeah.
So and that's quite. It can be quite heavy after a long time, and you're turning it.
You're always turning it. Yeah. So it's you have to rely on other, or I rely on other people to work with me. Mm-hmm. So, and so that's where that strong relationships with other people are formed too. So, yeah.
Now, Brian, dizzying these maximal environments that you create, and these stories that seem epic, perhaps this image on screen, what do we see in that particular one that's just gone past?
Well, that one there's called Light in the Darkness. So it's basically the introduction of Christianity into
coming of the Torres
Straits. Yeah, mm-hmm. Coming of the Light. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a very, you know, sort of, unfortunately, a very sort of timely, you know, sort of period in the creation of, you know, sort of Torres Strait culture, as you know, sort of London Missionary Society, where you know, sort of spreading the word of the word of God throughout the islands. Yeah. Yes, you know, and converting all the so-called you know, sort of heathens throughout that area. And you know, it's both seen as, you know, a time of celebration, mm-hmm. bringing, you know, another sort of God mm-hmm. into the culture, mm-hmm. but also seen as a destructive, you know, sort of mechanism as well, which, you know, at that sort of point in time, destruction of a lot of the ancestral, you know, sort of ways of life, ancestral knowledge, ceremonial objects were destroyed, unfortunately, and, you know, and so on and so forth. It's a period now that's, you know, celebrated right throughout the Torres Strait. There's a huge celebration that happens, you know, sort of July 1. On pretty much every island, as well as here on the Australian mainland as well. Any place that has significant, you know, sort of population of Torres Strait, you know, sort of people will celebrate, yeah.
150th
years, yeah, definitely.
And I think the celebrations were centred on, were they on Arabs? There were big celebrations on Arab.
Yeah, well, the Arab at a place called Kimas was the first point of call.
The landing point.
The landing of, yeah, LMS. The boat Surprise, and you know
the boat was named Surprise.
The boat was named Surprise. Yes, surprise. Yes, very ironic. Surprise. We're here, you know.
We're not bringing
up, you know, sort of the lantern as well. So it was, yeah, that first sort of contact, you know, sort of period for a lot of Torres Strait people, you know, particularly with conversion into Christianity and around that period.
And what I also love, though, that there are little hints in your work of something more, something cheeky, something about contemporary visual culture.
Mm.
And is that Miffy in the background there?
That is Miffy, definitely. Yes, Miffy. Part of a larger national exhibition that you know, a number of Australian artists were invited to respond to. You know, the good old, you know, little white rabbit called Miffy by Dick Bruner. A cherished, very cherished, you know, sort of figure actually throughout history. And I was one of those artists that was chosen to respond. So in, you know, sort of true Robinson fashion, I suppose, I created this large metre by 2 metre block, placing Miffy at the centre of that work as the sort of the godly sort of figure, and then looking at all the different long-eared, you know, sort of, yeah, rabbits and, you know, variations of rabbits throughout, you know, sort of history on, you know, sort of on the big screen throughout, you know, sort of comic books and things like that. So I think all up there's the same number, you know, sort of, if you think of Miffy as that god figure in the middle, all of his
permutations,
yeah, aspects, all of his, you know, aspects, sort of disciples and, you know, sort of, yeah, people sitting around him. So it's the same number. And then, you know, you always add in, you know, little references to pop culture as well into that, hidden through a lot of the traditional Torres Strait patination, which is called mineral. So, you know, it's for me to produce works like that, the fun aspect needs to be there first. So I love having fun with, you know, exploring the concepts behind the works. Developing the works themselves, there's always, you know, blood, sweat and tears that go into development of, you know, not only print work but also sculpture. But yeah, it's, you know, welcome to the Robinson realm.
So how big generally is your scale? 1 meter by one?
Yeah, that has become the standard size block.
Wow.
So I'll grab a large block.
We're talking about vinyl cut here.
Yeah, a vinyl cut. Throw it onto a large table and
just for those who don't know how vinyl cut works. Can you say what your material is and what you're cutting with?
Well, it started off initially as silk cut linoleum, I suppose a substrate, you know, that is quite soft that you can physically hand carve into. So I'll get a large block, I'll throw it onto a tabletop, I'll compose probably, I don't know, maybe 25-30% of it in terms of, you know, sort of setting out the composition of figures and everything like that.
So you're drawing in chalk onto the vinyl?
Yeah, no, generally it's coloured pencil. So, you know, yeah, taking me back even further, you know, when I used to use coloured pencil around the house, draw on the table, on the walls and all that sort of stuff. So it's bringing back, and you know, that memory of the childhood, you know, sort of drawing experience, as well as, you know, the mastering of that drawing technique initially. So that all of my works start off as that drawn aspect first. And then from there, physically, you know, sort of pulling out tools and starting to hand carve all the line work and then all the patterns that, you know, sort of are the last component, I suppose, to the print.
I mean, there has to be some kind of, there's a, for you, what is the referential air, how is air present in the work? Because you've made a work for a video for the Children's Art Centre. A beautiful work, but you know, air and the winds are absolutely essential, and the stars are another thing, and they're kind of in the air as well.
But yeah, well, if you look at the piece in the Children's Art Centre, a piece called Lagalgal, which means the people that are present on country, so the people that belong to that country. So it talks about the Torres Strait Islanders and how they live within their realm. So both on the islands, in the waters, and how they're represented in the skies above. So it's basically, you know, sort of the land, the sea, and the sky. So in terms of the air, and you are correct, you know, there is no traditional word for air. The closest that it comes would be gub, and gub is the winds. And there are four main winds that, you know, sort of course through the Torres Strait. And they set the rhythm of life for all the, you know, sort of people up in that area, which is also reflected up into the stars and the main constellations that also affect, you know, sort of social activity, as well as, you know,
animal
sort of
behavior,
growth of life and all that sort of stuff.
Animal behaviour, like when you could fish.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
When you could get to that next island, when it was safe enough for you to get there. And these extraordinary maritime journeys that the Torres Strait Islanders did between, you know, the islands of the Torres Strait and Papua New Guinea.
Yeah, correct.
So, Yhonnie, here we're looking at images from the installation of this, is it Cloud Chamber? This is Cloud Chamber, okay.
Yeah.
At the Tarawarra Museum of Art in the, which valley is it? Thank you. Which valley? It's one of those valleys. Yeah. Yarra Valley. It's beautiful backdrop, Wurundjeri country. And when I look at these images, I mean, that thing comes alive. That window is extraordinary. But this work resonating and kind of echoing across country is a beautiful thing. What do you think about the installation of a Cloud Chamber here at QAGOMA?
Yeah, it's really beautiful. I think with the clouds themselves, they're meant to inhabit space regardless of where they are. And I think with Cloud Chamber at Tarawarra, when it was quite a long space and the window, we talked about that a lot, the window being open and the landscape changing over the course of the exhibition. And it was probably the first time we actually used a lot of natural light. Usually it's
artificial.
And so with Cloud Chamber here, it's the first time too that it's exhibited with other works beside it. So it's interesting, even like I was there this morning again looking at it from this side as well, and how it's speaking with other works you know, technically floating in space as well. So what I found really beautiful with this as well is that the shadows are very much more prominent here than they were at Tarawarra.
I managed to take a photograph. I've always tried to photograph the shadows underneath the works, because there's always that space underneath. It's always been very difficult, but yesterday I was able to finally capture the shadows. And for me, the shadow play has always been a fascinating aspect of it, because you can look at the yams. I've always said this about the yams, and whether it's, you know, yams, there are other kinds of bush food that your ancestors harvested, which become the vessels for Well, they mean many things.
Mm.
But for me, they've always been anthropomorphic. Yep. They've always represented the human body. But we should say that you happen on this idea of composing the form of a dispersing cloud.
Mm. Yeah.
What kind of cloud?
Well, this one is the lower half of the breakaway bomb that was tested at Maralinga. And so we, me and Mikhail Roderick.
Late 50s or early 60s breakaway?
Late 50s, I think, yeah. So it I was always told those tests happened for 10 years.
Mm.
Maybe in the history books, as you would call it, it probably say something different, but yeah. And so I often look at archival images of the bombs when you can find them.
Mm-hmm.
They tend to appear and disappear online. And so with this, I was interested in the impact or first impact of the bomb as it rose from the ground. So with breakaway, it was... The bomb was so hot it turned the ground to glass. Mm-hmm. And I had heard through talking to people in the UK as well that the ground, the surf or the first layer of the earth was taken up with that.
Into the plume.
And then thrown.
The topsoil was lifted up into the cloud.
Cloud and...
And carried away and dispersed.
Yeah, yeah. And then, yeah.
I've got to stop using my hands.
Yeah. So I thought this one needed to, represent that moment.
Mm.
So I've cut the top half of the plume off and was wanting to create something that was a little more creepier than the others that I've created. So this one has like arms on the ground and it has a head and a neck, even though the cloud itself... was like taller than that. So, but it's also meant to represent that moment where they start to be blown with the wind and
mm-hmm. and they're just starting to move across.
So I think this one is like creeping along a little bit. And it's probably the one of the clouds that is more narrow. The others are more denser in terms of the installation. It's an interesting one.
And during the tests, the British tested their nuclear weapons, their arsenal of highly experimental nuclear weapons in the South Australian desert in country that abuts a good with the country. We're talking about Arangu, Pinjara, Yangunjara land, but very a vast part of the continent. And there are the Maralinga Jaratra people who were all moved off country to places like Yalata, Oak Valley. Oak Valley.
And further south, to Yalata. Mm. And then probably even further than that too. So there were people living at Kunuba Mission where my grandfather was born. So it's kind of, moving them south, but then it's like there's mob up in the APY lands that didn't go anywhere, so.
And now they're almost cleaved in two.
Yes.
And the derivation of identity is from a moment of crisis, of disaster, of loss and dispossession.
Mm.
And there was very little, as I understand it, very little explanation about why they had to be moved.
Mm.
It was a harebrained attempt at clearing the land of a human presence, it should be said.
Yep.
There was one man in charge for a charge of the entire testing range, which is massive.
Mm.
Still one of the most active weapons testing ranges in the world, the Woomera.
Yeah, it's still active. Yeah. That prohibited area is still very much being used. Mm. Probably mostly for drones.
Mm-hmm.
Who else knows what's gone on out there? But,
I mean, the thing is, and you talk about the research that you were doing in Britain. We'll talk. Just want to mention this quickly.
Mm.
The British, all the results of the experiments I mean, it wasn't just atomic weapons which were tested. A whole range of other components were tested.
Mm.
In a work you produced some years ago, strontium 19.
90, I think.
It's science. I don't know. Strontium 19. Strontium 90. It was about what had been, tests that had been conducted on the bones of infants who'd had died prematurely.
Mm.
And you had photographs of the graves of these babies at Woomera,
yeah,
where you yourself were born.
Mm.
The British tested the bones of infants, stillborn babies,
yeah,
for the presence of strontium 90. Mm. Isn't it a byproduct of nuclear fission?
Yeah, yeah. So they would look for it in the bone marrow,
without the parents' permission.
Without the parents' permission. So,
but with the Australian government, I understand, gave them permission to.
Yeah,
those samples were collected.
Yeah. So,
secretly.
Yeah, and so because it took me a long time to go back to Woomera as well. I think as a child, because I was born there, and then we moved away, and then I only probably started returning in the last decade, and then I think even before I was went to art school, and because I felt a bit weird about being born on a military base, and then because all my other siblings were born in other major cities and stuff. So, but I understood, I think, later that maybe there's something. It was fortuitous, and I try to go back at least twice a year, and Woomera is changing all the time, and it's very, like we were saying before, it's still very much an active test area, and depends on when you're in town. But there's military that come and go, and often you'd see that it has a lot to do with artificial intelligence. And but I go back not just because of that, but also just I call the children in the cemetery my friends. So, the more I talk to people about those babies out there, the more you sort of realise that they're probably not there. Mm. Their remains are probably have been exhumed. Mm. But, I guess we'll. Hopefully one day we will find out.
There was a very high number of miscarriages.
Yeah, yeah, and they used to, and stillborns and babies with deformities, and then they would blame the weather on those deaths. So, but it was pretty obvious it had a lot to do with the nuclear tests that were going on. It's actually technically, distance-wise, it's not very far away.
No. Yeah. And we talk about the tracking of the wind of the plume across country. Now the RAF, RAAF, and the RAF were the people who ran the tests.
Mm.
So even though they were working on the country, mostly it was Air Force,
mm.
and they would be involved directly in the tracking of the movement of the cloud, the radioactive cloud, across country. They would. Mm. Be taking sample readings, literally opening the window while they're flying the plane,
yeah.
collecting air
yeah,
samples.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
These are British and Australian
yeah.
Air Force personnel yeah. collecting samples, just as I described,
yeah.
by putting an arm out a window.
Yeah, yeah. And they're flying right through the clouds as yeah. well.
So for its radioactive, for its load.
Yeah, and they would fly out from Woomera.
Mm-hmm.
Like Maralinga has its own air base. Or airstrip, but they would, send pilots out from Woomera too. So, yeah.
Mm. There is another. My fascination with, as you know, is my fascination is with the first test on the Australian mainland in '53 at Emu, Emu Field or Emu Junction, when they started, and those weapons they tested in '53 were highly experimental.
Mm.
They still don't really know what was tested. And Blackfellas, Anangu and other mob, even though the Royal Commission into the nuclear tests found there was no evidence of the direct loss of life as a result of the tests, because they couldn't put cancer or anything, a range of other diseases down to anything. It could be natural. But Anangu mob, you ask people like Iluwanti Ken or senior artists who make work about that resonates with the nuclear tests. If people died, they will tell you they died.
Yeah. A lot of it was like chest infections too, through breathing.
Diarrhea, vomiting.
Yeah, through breathing in that toxic air. Yeah.
And old man Lester, Kumar Lester, attested that his eyes were affected. And he was a senior. He was a traditional owner who people will remember spoke at the handback of Uluru in 1985, and he remained blind from the time he was 10 until he passed away. But being struck blind by what they called the black smoke, the evil smoke, the dark smoke.
And you often hear stories about it creeping up and quite low on the ground as well.
Through the bushes.
Through the bushes,
Brian, this one. What do we call those glass balls that were suspended in those nets, those things? They seem to be everywhere, those things.
And they're green, yeah? They're green.
Well, they could be iridescent or clear.
They're blue, there's purple, there's clear. But they're the traditional, I suppose, you know, sort of glass floating boys that were slung over, you know, the sides of, you know, sort of purling luggers and things like that.
These are ornamental, though.
Yeah, these ones, you go through the Torres Straits and, you know, there are old boys that, you know, sort of literally hang in all the, you know, sort of low-lying mango trees and, you know, sort of surrounding houses. So you go up there and you look around, you know, sort of at all the houses and it's a fisherman's, you know, sort of paradise with all of these, you know, sort of flotsam and jetsam, you know, from the waters, basically. This particular work here, Fisherman's Still Life with Air Jordan 4s, I suppose looks at my grandfather's, you know, sort of connection with the water. So as a young fella, he started pearl diving from the age of 16, and by the age of 21, he was lead skipper and number one diver for a number of pearl luggers through the straits. And you know, the connection to air. You know, when you're actually walking, you know, the ground, the floors across Torres Strait is a vital, you know, extremely vital to keep you going. And the amount of times that he got the bends, you know, sort of within that, you know, sort of industry is amazing. It's probably one of the things that, you know, sort of sustained him for, you know, for such a long time, because he only passed away a few years ago at the age of 99.
Wow.
And, you know, for a black fella to get to, you know, that sort of age in this country is quite remarkable. And so this print here, you know, really, you know, sort of, is in memory of him. So down the one side of the house, there was a large sort of anchor rope that was strung between two large trees. And that's where he used to throw all his cast nets for, you know, when they need to be repaired. There are a number of buoys, you know, showing in this image here that used to also hang along that, as well as all other, you know, sort of manner of fishing paraphernalia. And, you know, sort of growing up up in the islands, you know, sort of I was quite a basketball, you know, sort of fanatic. Had a whole stack of, you know, sort of Air Jordans.
I was
going to
say, did your grandfather wear
Air Jordans? No, he just got around barefoot, you know, most of the time, mate. And so, you know, when it would rain, you know, you'd be walking to school, your shoes would get, you know, sort of soaked with water. And so when I'd come home in the afternoons, that's where I'd throw my shoes to have them dried. And so, yeah, it's bringing back, you know, sort of all these, you know, sort of memories.
And you call
really about growing up on the island and, you know, all of those different experiences.
It's a still life, you call it.
It is a still life, yes, yeah.
I was surprised to see you actually in the still life. There's a, I guess, a contemporary take on the European tradition of still life in the upper, one of the upper galleries. And I was like, why would he call this, why is this a still life? Because that's quite different, that work up on the second level.
Yeah, well, that's a collaborative piece, actually. So myself and a young Torres Strait printmaker, female printmaker living here in Brisbane, Tamika Grant Irimu, actually worked on that piece, you know, sort of up in my studio in Cairns. So it's quite a massive, you know, sort of wall installation composed of different size, you know, sort of geometric blocks that have been carved, you know, sort of in the style of relief prints, printed, then, you know, sort of dispersed across the wall in probably more Tamika's, you know, sort of style of composing her prints. So it was a grant that, you know, sort of she had received through the Australia Council, and she was asking, you know, basically me to mentor her through the process of, you know, sort of printmaking, connecting with, you know, sort of the broader, you know, sort of Torres Strait culture, and how all of those connections can, you know, sort of be represented in, you know, sort of one work. And so there are a number of, you know, sort of scenarios all sort of playing out in that work. But it was deliberately, you know, sort of put into the corner of the room. And that, over, you know, sort of time of developing the work, we could have went with, you know, the larger, you know, sort of flat, you know, sort of composition. But we went with the corner, you know, sort of display, because once you actually get up into the work, you feel more
enveloped,
probably, yeah, immersed in the piece. So everywhere you sort of turn and look, you're still submerged in the piece.
I was saying to you, Yhonnie, I'm not a huge fan of artists who create maximal environments and force you to feel something which is disorienting. And there is a work in Air which is precisely that. I think there's I just get a sense of just, you know, it, a tiny, there are tiny things in the exhibition as well. I don't know, there's always this kind of sense that visual art has to do this thing like a theatre. It has to create, it has to compel you to feel something. Whereas it can be quiet, it can make its point if it's got one, gently. You don't need a maximal environment. But I love what I see in your work is this kind of very such detail. And, you know, we were talking about one of the images before, and I pointed out the men with the turtle shell masks. Yes. Talk about they're slightly a bit phantom-like, those figures in your work. But what do they refer to? Something more traditional?
Yeah, they do, actually. And it's interesting that you've used, you know, sort of the terminology phantom-like.
Mm.
Because my late grandfather was a phantom comic fan.
Weren't all our grandfathers?
Loved phantom, yeah. Phantom
didn't,
comics.
Didn't every black fellow love the phantom?
Yeah, well, I think they did. You know, one of the first superheroes, actually.
Yeah, absolutely.
Probably, you know, sort of my connection into, you know, that sort of superhero realm was, you know, sort of through my, yeah, sort of late grandfather. But the turtle shell masks, which, you know, in this particular image here, you can see the figure up in the top corner as well, wearing, you know, a very plain, you know, sort of turtle shell masks. It, the tradition of turtle shell mask making really sat within the male's domain in the Torres Straits, and it was a ceremonial, you know, sort of practice. So quite elaborate turtle shell masks were, you know, sort of fabricated from only one particular turtle, which was the hawksbill turtle. So there are a number of species of turtle that go through the Torres Straits. The green turtle itself is, you know, sort of caught for food. But the hawksbill was never caught for food. It was purely caught for the shell, for the carapace. So it was a very lengthy process of boiling and peeling away the layers of the turtle shell. To get flat, you know, sort of plates that were then moulded into these large, elaborate masks, some with, you know, the nose of crocodiles with the tails of, you know, sort of sharks. So, you know, that real, you know, sort of metamorphosis of, you know, sort of animals that were basically cut in half and, you know, sort of put together into one large ceremonial mask. I've represented, you know, sort of those masks just with the plain ceremonial. So it gives audiences an understanding that these types of materials were used, but not giving away the full extent of that ceremonial practice.
And I think that's why I seized on it, because there's this idea that everything that we do is has some reference to tradition and to traditional culture. It may well do, but we are also making things that are contemporary.
Definitely.
And doing things to, and that's what I love about your work. There's always these little, you think you're seeing something, but you're not seeing something. You're intrigued because you can identify those Air Jordans and the other things, but the patination is traditional.
Yes.
The style is traditional.
Exactly.
Mm. And in the Torres Strait, I mean, I love the revival that's happened in the last 20, 30 years. And this, I mean, I call it revival, but when it became, this patination became omnipresent in contemporary art from the Torres Strait Islands. And lino, were they first using lino cut, or was it always been vinyl cut?
Yeah, no. It started off as lino, and it's now gone into commercial sort of flooring vinyl, which is, you know, a lot easier to get, a lot cheaper to purchase as well, and a lot more robust. So, it's, you know, it has longevity. Mm. So when you look at printing, you know, sort of large editions of works, if you've, you know, got the cash, you'd print out your entire edition of, say, you know, 30, 40, you know, sort of prints. Mm. But generally you'd probably, you know, sort of slash it in half.
Before, do
the first half, yeah. Do the next half later. Yeah. So your block needs to, you know, be able to withstand that period of time without breaking down and, you know, losing all the sharpness of the line work and stuff like that. But in terms of, you know, just that, the genesis of Torres Strait printmaking, it really started, would have been the late 80s, early 90s, in Cairns, actually at the Cairns TAFE College, under the tuition of a woman by the name of Anna Gledis. And she was the one that really pushed printmaking to all the students, but it was the Torres Strait males that really, you know, sort of took it up and sort of run with it. And so I'm one of a small handful of, you know, yeah, the original cohort that really pushed the boundaries in terms of, you know, printmaking for Torres Strait people, as well as, you know, sort of printmaking just generally, really. And the blocks have just gone bigger and bigger and bigger, really, over time. And there was a project that, you know, that I worked on just a couple of years ago, which started as a large cylindrical lino cut work, and we turned that into the athlete's parade track at the Commonwealth Games that was on the Gold Coast. So a large track that, you know, yeah, large print that literally wrapped.
Transferred it onto a track.
Yeah, straight onto the competing track around the Carrara Stadium.
Wow.
Absolutely amazing. Amazing project to be a part of.
Yeah, so and it's shot from the sky, you would see the image.
Yeah, yeah. Go on, you know, sort of Google Commonwealth Games 2018 or whenever it was, and, you know, all the images of the track will be there. And I've still got masses of track at my house.
Anyone need any track?
And so, you know, yeah, I could do a Christo, you know, sort of wrap of my house with the amount of track that I still have. You know, this house, you know, cruise down Hollywood Boulevard in White Rock where I stay, and you'll see this black and white house, you know, with all of this patination across the house.
Now, you're using ink here in the vinyl, in the prints?
Yes.
Yeah, black ink.
Yep.
And when you're cutting into the vinyl, what colour is the vinyl?
The stuff that I use is, you know, it's a varied colour, but the stuff that I'm currently cutting is a light grey. And so I'll draw with that, you know, generally with either a red coloured pencil or a blue coloured pencil, so, you know, the markings actually, you know, physically stand out, and then I can, you know, sort of gear carve the line work after
with
that.
With a scalpel you're carving? How do you cut
specific
with
lino cutting tools.
Okay, cool. Oh, yeah.
Various, you know, sort of blades. Various, you know, sort of, I do say, you know, sort of various blades, but I also pull out, you know, sort of the good old power drills, you know, as well, cordless drills, make, you know, the perfect circle every time.
Wow.
So often people will say, you know, and because I do constellation work, a lot of dots, a lot of little stars, you know, sort of, yeah.
It's a lot quicker.
Through the top.
Yeah,
and they'll often ask me, how do you get that perfect circle?
Mm.
Power drill. Power tool. You know, every time you just stand there and you literally drill, drill, drill. Yeah.
And the introduction of colour in this one. You're generally working in monochrome?
Yeah, generally, yeah. Well, actually, yeah, probably 95% of the time it's, yeah, it's monochromatic. But with that one there, it was a focus on how fire was brought to the Torres Straits. So it looks at a traditional, you know, sort of narrative from the area. And so with that one, there's a lizard, a frill net lizard that you can see in the print with the body of a man. And so that is the leader of all the lizards, a guy by the name of Wallach. Mm-hmm. So he was in the Torres Straits, you know, sort of traditional times. There were no humans that populated the islands. It was just all lizards. And so their main source of food was fish. And so they'd catch a fish. They had no fire or, you know, sort of access to that. So they'd get the fish, throw it on the hot rocks, heat it from the sun. It'd cook a little aspect of the fish. They'll turn it over quickly, you know, sort of munch it, flip it back over, cook some more, turn it back over, you know. Mm-hmm. So it took a while for you know, just one little piece of fish, you know, to be, you know, cooked and eaten. Yeah. And over the years, you know, they'd see a white sort of billowing, you know, sort of puffs of smoke coming from the horizon, wondered what that was. And so they all turned to their leaders, you know, we need to go and explore what was, you know, what's happening in the northern horizon. And so one by one, they, you know, sort of were sent out across the waters. Some were too light, were pushed around by the wind too much, so quickly scurried back to the island. Mm-hmm. Some were too heavy, you know, started to sink, so they quickly sent back to the island. Wallach, being the frill-neck lizard, quite an agile, you know, sort of lizard, could scurry across, you know, the waters, and that's what he did. He made his way all the way up to the northern horizon, up onto the beach, walked up to a small village, and in the process of him, you know, sort of going up to the village, he turned himself into a male in order to interact, you know, with all the villagers there. And he saw where the smoke was actually coming from, the hot, you know, sort of coals around this fire. And so what he did, he actually stole a piece of coal. But he needed all his limbs to, you know, to swim back to his home island. So he threw the little piece of coal into his mouth to keep it safe. Yeah. Mm. So he quickly scurried back, got up onto the beach, passed, you know, the coal out, and they quickly made, you know, all
these
fires.
You're saying he swallowed it?
Yeah, no, just popped it into his mouth. Gave it around, and, you know, that's how they made fires, and they sort of transported that main fire to all the other islands, and that's how fires sort of spread throughout the Torres Straits. Mm. But when you look at the frill-neck lizard these days, and, you know, frill-neck lizard, they're quite, you know, sort of feisty little, you know, little characters. But when he opens his mouth, there's a little black mark on his tongue, and that's where the coal burned him on the tongue.
Ah. What's that fella's name?
Wallach.
And, you know, there's so many narratives. I always think of stories from the Torres Strait, like the one you just told, as epic. And almost unending. And when I look at one of your works, I think this is very many chapters in a book.
Oh, yes, yeah.
And sometimes when they talk about, you know, song cycles in Arnhem Land or other parts of Australia, when fellas sit around, when mobs sit around and sing, those stories go on forever. There's no way I could tell you what that story is. It's so long and it can go for days. So this idea of story being something that is endless and continuous and still relevant today.
Yeah. Well, I remember, you know, as a young fellow when I was doing curatorship at the Cairns Art Gallery, developing a large Torres Strait exhibition called Island Passin.
Oh, yes. Very important exhibition.
I had my main, you know, sort of elders, you know, sort of spread throughout the region, but there was a gentleman in Cairns by the name of Uncle Edric Tabuai, and he's got pieces in this collection as well. Amazing dancer, but amazing storyteller. And everything, every word that came out of his mouth was poetic. Mm-hmm. And he didn't talk to, you know, just, you know, sort of generally, you know, everything was in yarn. Everything was, you know, that full story, that really strong narrative. And that's how he would, you know, sort of relate to everyone. Mm.
That knowledge transfer, and part of why I struggled when I was writing the essay for this exhibition, and when Geraldine approached me to write about air, I was like, what? No, please. This is impossible. How do you write about air? Because I can't tell you there was a concept of air. I can't talk to my ancestors. I can't ask my ancestors what they thought of air. Did it occur to them? I had to imagine. Well, yeah, it's visible. It's visible in places. It's visible to the eye. But wind is something very, very cultural and very well understood. And the winds have names, don't they?
They do. Yeah. The four main winds in the Torres Straits are Sagir, which is the southeast trade winds. There's Cookie, which is the northwest. Mm-hmm. So the monsoon winds that bring all the rains. There's Zay, which is the southerly winds. They blow sort of periodically throughout the year, and then Nagai, which is the northerly winds. And so those four winds really set the seasons as well as the stars. Through the straits.
Mm-hmm. Mm. When Geraldine approached you to ask if Cloud Chamber could be included in this exhibition called Air, what did you think? You've heard some crazy ideas, from curators. I'm not sure about that one. No.
Yeah, I think for me it made sense. I think because of how. The story of stories of the nuclear clouds moving across country. Mm-hmm. I think so.
Noiselessly.
Yeah. Very silent. Yeah.
Stealthy,
very. Yeah.
Toxic.
Yep. Yeah. So it was. It was. An interesting. Yeah, interesting topic. I think in terms of air. Mm-hmm. I think. Because I think when they think about those nuclear tests, the clouds did, they did have toxic substance in them.
Oh, yes.
And so it was very much felt on the skin and in the eyes and in the chest and things. So it's kind of it was something that was... they were unassuming, I think, that there was something about them that you didn't think that you would be breathing something in, because it was like radiation poisoning is often touch, through touch, or I'm no scientist,
no.
But it's kind of...
you forced me to have a scientist.
So it's something, something that you... And I didn't really like science at school too, so it was interesting how I really like looking at that type of...
Because the records, the archives of... were as many papers concerned with the British nuclear tests are held in the UK.
Yeah.
So we're talking about Sir James Penny was the nuclear physicist who'd just recently been knighted by the Queen. And a flying trip to Emu Field to choose Emu Field and to name it Emu Field because he saw an emu. James Penny was the man who, the nuclear physicist in charge of the tested emu.
Mm.
So the British hold all the records of what was tested, and Australian authorities have probably, safe to say, not very much data about the materials that were used.
Yeah, I think there's probably mostly photographs here, and I'm yet to see that scientific reference material because it is still classified.
Was it Sir Raphael Cialento? Who's the one whose records are held in Birmingham? Which of the new?
Oh, it's Frisch and Pirelles. Right. So and Oliphant.
Mark Oliphant.
Yeah. So they those.
I think he went on to become governor of South Australia. Didn't
he did. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because he's from SA too.
He was a nuclear physicist also a chemist, something like that.
Both, I think.
Anyway, he had some senior role
he employed Frisch and Pirelles because of their interest in nuclear energy, and so I saw a lot of the archival material, not just in Birmingham but Oxford and Cambridge, because they were spread across many different or different universities. Like Aston University was involved as well. So there's that early thoughts, I think, that, and I saw documentation that was once, top secret. Mm-hmm. So you get the stamps on the folders.
Classified
and stuff.
Top secret, yeah. Didn't the British close their archive relating to the British?
They did, yeah. They did open and then they closed, yeah. So they forget that Blackfellas are patient too. So I'll wait. Yeah.
Long time.
Yeah.
Well, it was funny because when they closed their archive relating to the tests, I was I had a podcast idea to make a program about emu. Then I was approached by Liz Tynan, who was from the University of Newcastle, a journalist, who wrote Maralinga Thunder, I think it's called.
Yeah.
Quite a well, I think it won Prime Minister's Literary Award, or either that or the new one did. But she's interested in emu too. My interest, I'm interested in all of them because of the impact on blackfellas. And the idea of this thing happening in the desert, which could not be explained, and suddenly appearing on the horizon. It's almost biblical in the way you can imagine it.
Yeah.
But I remember there was another thing I always talk to you about in my research into, not breakaway, but into one of the other explosions. When the British were trying to leave Maralinga, they hit on this idea of we have to dispose of all the material, defence material. So I'm talking about tanks and trucks, and because they're contaminated, right?
Yeah.
So they buried a pit and used molten glass, a process called vitrification, to render that material inert.
Yes.
But it failed terribly. So this is another resonance with glass and...
Yeah, yeah. And if anyone's seen examples of that glass, is like it's not like... Like it's really...
It's dirty.
It's dirty,
And when you go, when you've been to Maralinga on those trips, you talk about how it crunches underfoot.
Yes.
The heat was so infernal during that breakaway explosion, but other explosions as well, that it crystallised the sand. The silica is what... Silica is what is in glass, molten glass.
Yeah, and I think because the land out there is red, the glass is a green colour. Like the one on the topsoil is dark green. Mm. The one that they've put in that they've buried is... That lighter, it's not green as I call it. So phlegm-like green. Yeah.
But they abandoned the vitrification process. It was too expensive.
And it's useless.
And the machine that was pouring the molten glass, because we're talking about huge volumes, massive pits, full of tanks and trucks, the machine couldn't handle the load of molten glass.
Mm.
And I think they threw their hands up and just ran away.
Yep. Yeah. Well, I call them tombs. They're tombs. Mm. Like they're, who knows what else is in there other than machinery. So, yeah.
Brian, so there's work up on the second floor, the still life,
the
collaboration, and the work in the Children's Art Centre, the video work, installation, what do you call it?
Animation.
And it's a beautifully narrated story. This one strikes me as a map with a Pac-Man. It's a map, isn't it? It's a map of cartographic illustration. What's happening in this one?
So this piece here is called Bedanlag, Land of the Kaiwalagal. So it basically looks at the movement of the Endeavour ship tracking up the eastern coast of the country. So you can see, from the cartographic map that's there, the east coast is blank. So it's about, the movement of the Endeavour. And the Endeavour itself is, right smack bang in the middle of the print itself, sailing in on a large stingray.
Oh, yeah.
So the stingray itself is one of my family's totems. So it's about, connecting my family or, my lineage back into the works, physically back into the works that I produce. So it's basically talks about, that first, probably one of the first, contact periods for the Torres Strait people, in terms of the... Europeans, you know, sort of sailing into the country and mapping, you know, sort of the coastline. So Bedan Lag is the traditional name for Possession Island. And so there are a number of stories, actually, when it comes to the supposed, you know, sort of planting of the flag on Possession Island, and naming, you know, sort of, yeah, all the creeks and inlets and, you know, coastline from there downwards for the greater
empire.
It's
like you forgot. Like, I better claim possession and plant the flag on Possession Island. The last it was practically the last piece of what would become the continent of Australia.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's right. So that small little island, you know, sort of, yeah.
Oops. Been, before I go,
been, you know, the probably the most forgotten about in terms of, you know, yeah, that overall, you know, sort of saga. And so there are many stories. So if you go up to places like Bamaga, you know, sort of talk to the mob up there, talk to, you know, people at Ingenue and Sazia, there are a number of stories about him not physically planting the flag, you know, the flag being wrapped around cannonballs and the cannonball being, you know, sort of shot over onto the island and, you know, so forth, and then the flag actually being, you know, sort of taken from the cannonball and used to wrap up babies and, you know, various, you know, sort of stories that have all come from, you know, the traditional mob up there. And there's one guy, one of the Kareg elders, he said, you know, it would have been a much different story if he'd only, you know, sort of sat down with, you know, with the elders and, you know, just sort of discussed what was happening. So if only Ambin comes today with Matt, with us, we'd been right. He would have been right then, but not. He didn't. He just, you know, sort of, yeah, supposedly flag, you know, panned the flag and kept going. So, yeah, it's interesting.
I think, you know, extraordinary failure of imagination is how I describe those very early days of contact. So it's lovely to talk to you and lovely to meet you finally after all these years, Brian.
Yeah, definitely.
I love your work and I'm seeing it big. Are there any really big public installations of the work? Like fabricated installations of the work in materials other than the ones that you're working with that you're not involved with, like steel or... Well, there should be.
There's one in Mackay. You've got one in Mackay?
Yeah. Public sculptures, I suppose, the second side to Robinson's realm, because you know I create public sculpture that, you know, sort of is in various locations right across the country, and it's one of those areas that you can work in that will, you know, sort of last anywhere from, you know, say 6 months to a year, sometimes to 2 years, as, you know, the project itself, you know, sort of manifests in all sorts of different ways. And so, you know, yeah, I've got, you know, sculptural works all around the place. But, you know, the print work itself, you know, when I spoke about, you know, the Carrara Stadium, it's probably the biggest print to date in the world. So if you think about a print that...
Is it still visible?
No. That was basically just printed onto large vinyl that then laid on the competing track. And so in terms of the scale of that print, if you can imagine a three-car lane, you know, sort of highway in width and then half a kilometre long, that's how big the print was.
Maximal. Can you please
maximum impact, mate.
Maximal. Can you please join me in thanking two artists featured in the Air exhibition here, the opening weekend at QAGOMA, Yhonnie Scarce and Brian Robinson.